It's time for you all to wake up and shift your paradigm. This world is the kingdom of darkness, and we are living in its last days. It won't be long before the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. The heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat, and the earth and everything therein shall be burnt up. The Luciferian elite have been setting up the New World Order, and now they've established the globalist beast system for the rise of that wicked one and revealing of the man of sin who comes after the workings of Satan. Don't take my word for it. Read the Bible, and you'll know that perilous times shall come in the last days. And we are in the last days.
Okay, greetings, brothers and sisters. We are continuing with our study on the book of Revelation. And this time we are going to look at Revelation chapter 6. Now, I'm going to read for us here. Now, when I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, "Come and see." And I looked, and behold, a white horse. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. Now, this is a very, very important part, Revelation 6 verses 1 and 2, because the rider on the white horse is a false Christ. Okay? He's not the Antichrist of Revelation chapter 13, but he is a false Christ. When you go into the research of the late Dr. Michael Heiser, and when you do a study on the Dictionary of Deities and Demons, that was Karel van der Turen and Bob Becking, and those people were the editors of that dictionary. If you do a study of Michael Heiser's work and you do a study of what the Dictionary on Deities and Demons in the Bible says, then you see that the entity on the white horse is the is a fallen angel that was worshipped by the Assyrians. This fallen angel is named Reshef. Okay? Now, a lot of people don't know this, but Reshef is actually alluded to in Psalm 91. There's a very deep history behind Psalm 91 that the churches will never talk about. I don't know why. Probably because the churches in our day and time love to ignore the spiritual. They don't want people to have knowledge about the spiritual world, about spiritual warfare, and about the spiritual battle that we are in. But Psalm 91 mentions actually four Assyrian demons, more specifically, four fallen angels that were worshipped by the Assyrians. And one of them is Reshef. If I'm not mistaken, it is when Psalm 91 says that you shall not be afraid of the, let me just make sure here of the exact wording, Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. Surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. The fowler is one of the fallen angels. The perilous pestilence is the next one. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night. There's the next one. The terror by night is actually the night terror or the night demon that is mentioned in Isaiah 34 verse 14. Now, in my humble opinion, the Bible translation that translates Isaiah 34 verse 14 the best is the New Revised Standard Version, the NRSV. The NRSV doesn't mince words. It doesn't mince words when it comes to Isaiah 34 14. It names Lilith by name. Lilith is the night terror. People who experience, people who've been deep into the occult who experience sleep paralysis will know the entity Lilith very well, because they say that they see her appear many times when they have experienced sleep paralysis in the past. Lilith is revered by many satanic cults as the guardian of prostitutes and the guardian of abortion. Okay? And she's referred to as the, it's basically a fallen angel that appears as a female, okay? And this fallen angel is also referred to as the terror of the night, okay? Then comes the next one, nor the arrow that flies by day. Now, the arrow that flies by day refers to the Assyrian entity Reshef. Reshef is a fallen angel that was revered by the Assyrians, and he always carried the bow, okay? And if you go into his background, he is a fallen angel who is basically the guardian or the symbol for war and plagues, okay? So he's a symbol for war and sickness, okay? Now, he comes on a white horse, so he's a false Christ. When you compare him to Jesus Christ, the true Christ, the true Messiah, in Revelation chapter 19, you see that Christ has very specific features that identifies him as the Word of God. Okay? He has a sword coming out of his mouth, which is the Word of God also. Okay? Because we know the Word of God is the sword of the Spirit, according to Ephesians 6. And we know that Jesus comes and he, with the mere breath of his mouth, he destroys the Antichrist. Now, the devil cannot fight directly against the Trinity, for the simple reason, God the Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit are almighty. Okay? The Trinity is almighty. Satan is mighty, but he's not almighty. So what he does is he creates counterfeits, okay? You get the Kundalini spirit, which is a counterfeit Holy Spirit. You get fallen angels like Tammuz, Reshef, Ketep, Molech, a lot of them. If I have to name all of them, we'll sit here for hours. There's a lot of false messiahs throughout history. Another one that I just thought of was Krishna, revered by many Hindu cults. And this Reshef in this instance comes with his bow. But pay close attention to the way that he's described. It says that he has a bow, but it doesn't mention any arrows. So in other words, he is the one that is described in Psalm 11, who shoots at the upright in heart with his arrows. Okay. Many times the Bible uses archers as a symbol for something ominous. Not always, because remember, Israel also had archers in their army. In those days, people had three major weapons that they fought with, either the sword or the spear or the bow. Okay. So many times the Bible uses an archer to portray something ominous. Okay, it depends on the context, because sometimes when it refers to archers, it means archers, physical soldiers who shoot with a bow and arrow. But Psalm 11, let's go to Psalm 11, is a very, very good example of the psalmist being aware, and Psalm 11 was written by David. David knew the spiritual world very well, just as the Apostle Paul did and the Apostle Peter did. And sadly, I think if they see our modern churches today, they would actually, I don't think they would know if they, I don't think they would know if they have to laugh or cry or whatever. Psalm 11, listen carefully. In the Lord I put my trust. How can you say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? For look, the wicked bend their bow, they make ready their arrow on the string, that they may shoot secretly at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Who's the foundation that we build on? The foundation that we build on is Jesus Christ. What the psalmist is saying is, this is basically, this psalm contains a very subtle prophecy, in the sense that it's saying there are false Christs, false messiahs who shoot at the upright in heart. Remember, Jesus is the King of righteousness, okay? And they shoot at the upright in heart, those who follow righteousness. And if the foundation, i.e. the true Messiah, if the foundation is destroyed, what he's saying is that if your belief in the true Messiah is destroyed, what then remains? What can the righteous do? So in other words, don't lend out your ears to the lies of the fallen one, the prince of darkness. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids test the sons of men. The Lord tests the righteous, but the wicked and the one who loves violence, his soul hates. Upon the wicked he will rain coals, fire and brimstone, and a burning wind shall be the portion of their cup. For the Lord is righteous, he loves righteousness, his countenance beholds the upright. Okay. It's interesting also that the wicked shoot at the upright in heart, and Jesus says in Luke 21 verse 26 that in the last days things will appear on the earth that will cause people's hearts to faint. Okay. Now, this relates to physical manifestations of fallen angels. It relates to physical manifestations of all kinds of evil on the earth. And I believe that the atheist scientists who basically worship intellectualism and who worship rationalism will see these things and they will get such a fright that their hearts will fail them. So there's a literal interpretation and there's also a figurative interpretation. The figurative interpretation is that these false messiahs in the last days will lead many astray and their hearts will fail. In other words, they will not be upright in heart anymore. You see, once again, the idea of a false messiah like Reshef shooting at the upright in heart, his arrows pierces their hearts and they fall for the lies. So they follow unrighteousness instead of the righteousness, the true righteousness that is found in Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay. Let's continue from there. The second seal, the conflict on earth. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature saying, come and see. Another horse, fiery red, went out, and it was granted to the one who sat on it to take peace from the earth, and that people should kill one another, and there was given to him a great sword. Now you see, when peace is taken from the earth, then all kinds of wars break out. Now I suspect that we have already seen a lot of peace taken from the earth, especially in the 20th century. You can argue with me all you want, But the fact of the matter is the 20th century is the bloodiest century in the history of mankind. More blood has been spilled in the 20th century than all the previous centuries combined. Okay? You had the First World War. Approximately 16 million soldiers on all sides died on the battlefield in the First World War. The Second World War was way higher casualty count. Okay? We know of 6 million Jews who died in the Holocaust. Another 5 million people, gypsies and so on, died also in the Holocaust. Millions of Soviets sacrificed their lives to fight against Hitler. Americans died. There was one town in France that had a population of 18,000 before the start of World War II. At the end of the war, their population was, I think, 300. I can't remember the town. But that is just an example to illustrate a massive amount of loss of life. Now, not even mentioning all the other wars, the Vietnam War, the Korean War, the Iran-Iraq War, the Gulf War, all those wars, the Soviet-Afghan War, then also the dictators of the 20th century, Joseph Stalin, the Soviet dictator. Approximately 50 million people died under him. Mao Zedong, the Chinese dictator, approximately 50 million people died under him. So people can argue with me all they want, but the 20th century was the bloodiest century in the history of man. Now, if that is not a part of taking peace from the earth, then I don't know what is. And I'm afraid we are in for another bumpy ride in the 21st century, because we know that now nuclear weapons are the big thing. And I know there's a lot of political correct political commentators who say, oh, nuclear war will never happen, blah, blah, blah. They can't tell me, their liberal minds tell them that nuclear war aren't going to happen because they just can't fathom it happening. Okay? The United States, Russia, North Korea, the UK, the European Union, none of them are going to go like this. Oh, we're not going to use nuclear weapons because so-and-so, who's a political commentator on this and this channel, said, oh, it would be so horrible if nuclear weapons would be used. It's mutual destruction, so we're not going to use them. The elite people of this world don't give a damn about the lives of civilians. If there's mutual destruction, they don't care. Because what is war essentially? And I will stand by this statement that I'm going to make now. War, I have a theory that war, all the lives lost in war, is actually a massive satanic sacrifice. All the blood that is spilled in war is a satanic sacrifice to honor the kingdom of darkness. That's all it is. There are no winners in a war. The third seal. When he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, come and see. So I looked, and behold, a black horse, and he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, a quart of wheat for a denarius, and three quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and the wine. So what you have here is worldwide economic collapse, worldwide inflation, worldwide famine. Okay. Now we are already getting a taste of that. If you look at the massive amounts of inflation all over the world, economic collapse all over the world. If I look at food prices, you know, food prices, not just here in South Africa where I live, but when I hear what people in Canada are saying about the ridiculous food prices in Canada, it's just totally ridiculous. And what's interesting here is it says at the end of verse 6, do not harm the oil and the wine. Now, what this is about is that the essential foods that people need to survive, like wheat and barley and so on, those foods will become very scarce. But additions to food, things like oil and wine, things that you don't essentially need for survival, will not be harmed. You see, that's the literal aspect. The figurative aspect is that the oil and the wine here might refer to the Holy Spirit. Okay? And the Holy Spirit, do not harm the oil and the wine, means those of you in those days who are still faithful followers of Christ, do not grieve the Holy Spirit, because you will need him now more than ever. Okay? Because we know the Holy Spirit is a guide, a comforter, and a protector. When he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature saying, come and see. So I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and the name of him who sat on it was Death, and Hades followed with him. And power was given to them over a fourth of the earth, to kill with the sword, with hunger, with death, and by the beasts of the earth. It's interesting in popular culture that Hollywood has such an obsession with death. It's almost as if they worship death. They worship death, promiscuous sex, money, all those things. But especially death. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God. Now, this refers to the Christian martyrs. People like the very first Christian martyr, Stephen, of whom we read in Acts chapter 7. Stephen, the Apostle Peter, remember Peter was crucified upside down. The Apostle Paul, we know that Paul was essentially, in the end, he was beheaded by the Romans. And it refers to all the Christian martyrs who died in the Colosseums, people who were ripped apart, sawn in pieces, ripped apart by wild animals in the Colosseum, killed by gladiators, etc. A very good example also of a Christian martyr is Polycarp. If you've never read the letter of Polycarp, do yourself a favor and go to Google and type in Polycarp, okay? P-O-L-Y-C-A-R-P, and then leave a space and then type PDF, and somewhere you'll find on Google, it will lead you to basically the martyrdom of Polycarp. That's what the letter was called, the martyrdom of Polycarp. And it's a wonderful piece of literature to read. It's considered to be an apocryphal work, okay? But it's a wonderful, it's wonderful reading material. Very sad, very tragic, but also very uplifting to see the massive faith, the steadfast faith that Polycarp had, his love for Christ, his love for the truth, his love for righteousness. It's absolutely wonderful. And for the testimony which they held, and they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer. I think this is the New King James I'm reading from. I think the original King James says something like, wait one season longer. Now that forms a very great parallel with Ecclesiastes chapter 3 that says, for everything there is a season. So the Lord works in seasons, and you know, even the martyrs in heaven cry out and they say, Lord, how long until you avenge our blood on the inhabitants of the earth, the godless ones who dwell on the earth? And the Lord says to them, just hold out for one season longer. And he comforts them, he gives them white robes. And it was said to them that they should not, that should rest a little while longer until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. So this indicates to us that in the last days, once again, Christian martyrdom will become a big thing. Christians will be persecuted, especially during the Great Tribulation. Okay. And then comes the sixth seal, which also relates very well to what Jesus said in Luke 21, verse 26, when he said that one verse earlier, Luke 21, verse 25, when he said that the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Okay. Now, the sixth seal deals with cosmic disturbances. I looked when he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. Just remember, when it mentions a fig tree, many times when the Bible mentions a fig tree is symbolic of the tree of life. So it is saying here, when it says that this, it drops from the sky like a fig tree drops down its figs, this is a symbol used to tell you, listen, everything will basically be everything will basically be consumed by death. It will be death and destruction on a massive scale. Okay? And that comes back to what I said earlier. I'm afraid that in the 21st century, when you look at the bloodbath of the 20th century, and I think that what is coming in the 21st century, in these last days, will even, I would dare to say that it will make the atrocities of the 20th century look like it will make it look like child's play. It will make it look like a kindergarten party. And I say this with greatest respect and love to all the victims in the Holocaust and all the victims of war in the 20th century. I don't mean this as disrespectful towards them. I'm not casting doubt on their suffering. But what I'm just saying is that I think what is coming in the last days will even be much worse than that. If you look at Israel, it also says in the Bible that there will be a faithful remnant, but 2/3 of the people will perish, and there will only remain a faithful remnant, okay? And that faithful remnant will see the one whom they pierced, the prophecy in Zechariah chapter 12, they will see the one whom they pierced, and they will weep bitterly. So there will be a few of the Jews who will then come to Christ and say, oh my goodness, this Messiah that we always thought was a false Messiah that our ancestors crucified, he is actually the true Messiah. We were wrong all along. And then they will repent and believe. And obviously we know that Christians who keep the faith until the very end, we all, with the faithful remnant of Israel, we all are like the spiritual Israel, okay? And we will be with Christ in the New Jerusalem. Hallelujah. I can't describe in words how much I look forward to that. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man, hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains. Now pay close attention. You know, it's always interesting to see the arrogance of people like, you know, world leaders, different type of world leaders who are part of the elite, who are part of the elite cabal, who are followers of the Order of the Black Sun and the Order of Freemasonry and the Rosicrucians and all these elite people who belong to them. They are so arrogant, they think they know everything and they can do whatever they want. But look what it says here. All these people, the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, all of them hid themselves in caves and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. So they will get such a massive fright that they will say to the mountains, fall on us. We will rather have you fall on us and crush us to pieces than to have to endure the wrath of the Lamb of God and of God the Father. And this is the irony. Even if the mountain should fall on them and they should die, they can't escape the judgment. They are going to have to stand before the judgment seat and they will have to give an accounting. And the Lord will say to them, depart from me, I never knew you. And I'm not trying to judge when I say that, but that is, I'm just giving facts. That's what the Bible says, okay? Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come. And it's interesting how they end this with a rhetorical question. Who is able to stand? Nobody will be able to stand when the wrath of God comes down on the godless. So you see, this is why the Lord constantly says in his word, do not take vengeance on others. Vengeance belongs to me. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. Okay? We should never take matters into our own hands because we have a human concept. We have a human perspective of righteousness and of justice. It is a frail, unperfect perspective. God the Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit has a perfect sense of justice, perfect sense of love, perfect sense of grace, perfect sense of peace, perfect sense of revenge. Okay? And we should leave the vengeance to God. Brothers and sisters, I love you all, and may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and give you peace.